대한민국을 지키는 새로운 날개 KF-21 보라매에 대한 국제적 관심도가 높아지고 있는 가운데 얼마 전 호주의 한 군사 전문 채널에서 KF-21 보라매를 세부 분석하는 영상이 올라와 큰 화제가 되고 있습니다. 올라온 지 며칠 만에 1,500개에 달하는 댓글이 달리며 국내뿐만 아니라 해외에서도 KF-21 뜨거운 관심을 보내고 있다는 사실을 보여주었는데요. 해당 영상과 함께 해외에서도 KF-21개발을 주목하고 있는 이유가 무엇인지 함께 알아보도록 하겠습니다.
For the past number of decades, the South Korean military has attempted to increase its ability to produce equipment domestically. Just as with its neighbor Japan, South Korea has a promising aerospace industry, yet for a variety of reasons, still primarily relies on other Western nations to provide aircraft and armament. However, in recent decades, Korea has made several moves to produce its own aircraft. Beginning in 1992, Korea Aerospace Industries began development on what would become known as the T-50, a supersonic jet trainer which could double as a combat aircraft if necessary. This aircraft, a fleet of which now exist, served as a proof of concept for what would become known as the Boramae, or Hawk, a new project seeking to develop a replacement for the aging fleet of F-4 Phantoms and F-5 Tigers still in service. First announced in 2001, the project was initially met with some skepticism, which was understandable. Korea was setting out, with only one training jet under their belt, to not only produce a fighter from scratch, but one that could rival the best American, Russian, and European designs, all of which have long histories designing and perfecting aircraft. For many years, the project was unable to garner serious interest. However, in 2010, this would change. Increasing pressure from North Korea led to a renewed national interest in the project. Winning the bid would be the tried and tested Korea Aerospace Industries, who chose to partner with Lockheed Martin for support. Thus, the project got underway. Nearly 11 years after the start of the program, on July 12, 2021, the first prototype was ready. Named KF-21, the aircraft attracted international attention. Notably, Poland, Peru, and the Philippines all expressed interest in the aircraft. Following this, work began on a further 8 aircraft, 2 ground test units, 2 twin seat flight units, and 4 single seat flight units. In July 2022, the first of these single seat flying units made its maiden flight. This would be followed up in November 2022 by a second aircraft, and in January 2023 by a third, which would also complete the first supersonic flight. In February 2023, the first two-seater aircraft would take flight. According to Korea Aerospace Industries, the current plan is to equip the Air Force with a fleet of 40 KF-21s by 2028, have a full fleet of 120 by the year 2032. These will be the initial Block 1 configuration, limited to air-to-air capabilities. Once this first phase is completed, the plan is to then begin a Block 2 program, which will roll out full air-to-ground capabilities. Why this unusual decision to launch without multi-role capabilities is unclear. If a guess had to be made, it is possible that the aim is to push the aircraft into service as quickly as possible while dealing with the more time-consuming technology in a second phase. It has also been noted by the designers that if Korea ever acquires aircraft carriers, a modified carrier version of the aircraft designated KF-21N could be produced within just a few short years.
실제로 KF-21의 개발이 결정되기에는 상당히 오랜 시간이 걸렸었지만 개발이 시작되고 지금의 단계까지 도달하는 것은 순식간에 이루어졌습니다. 세계 항공기 개발사를 뒤져보아도 유례없는 스피드였죠.
The future multi-role nature of the aircraft has been highlighted since the initial flight tests. Ordnance will include such ground weapons as GBU-12 Paveway 2s, various JDAMs, and CBU-105s, a modified version of the American CBU-97 cluster bomb, to name a few. Possible air-to-ground missiles include the anti-ship AGM-84 and the AGM-65 Maverick. In terms of air-to-air weaponry, the aircraft should be capable of carrying standard American weapons, namely the AIM-120 AMRAAM for BVR and the AIM-9X for close range, along with plans to integrate the ASRAAM, a supposed Sidewinder replacement. However, the loadout of choice for the aircraft appears to be a combination of the Meteor Active Radar Missile for long range and the Iris-T Infrared for close range. MBDA, the European company behind the Meteor, announced that they had been working with Korea Aerospace Industries to integrate the missile into the KF-21 platform. This choice is rather interesting, as for many years, the tried and tested AMRAAM was considered the most reliable active radar missile available. However, since its initial testing, the Meteor possibly outperforms the American design. South Korea also plans to integrate its fleet with air-launched cruise missiles, or ALCMs. This was confirmed by South Korea's Defense Acquisitions Program Administration, DAPA, with the system development phase coming into effect on December 12, 2023, and a slated completion date of 2028. These designs, named Sky Dragon, have already been test-launched from Korean F-4Es, and it has been insinuated that such a missile would have a range of 500 kilometers. The South Koreans are not only focused on close air support, but also precision strike capability, given a 500-kilometer range of the most important North Korean infrastructure from the South's northern border. North Korea lacks a modernized air force, but it does have one of the largest standing armies in the world, with heavily fortified command and control infrastructure. A 500-kilometer range ALCM could be launched from an aircraft without encroaching North Korean airspace. Although we don't know the details, it is likely that the ALCM program will have bunker-busting capability. This is implicit when suggestions have been made that the ALCM may replace the existing kept 350K cruise missiles, a system said to be able to penetrate up to 20 feet of concrete. These programs fall under Korea's three-axis operational plan, which seeks to prevent any nuclear threat from the North. This includes surprise first strikes on nuclear weapons positions, followed by the interception of any cruise missiles. The third axis, known as overwhelming response, would serve as a retaliatory strike campaign if the North made the first move, with primary targets being command and control structures and launch sites. The KF-21 and cruise missile program are integral to the development of this plan. So, what about the performance and real-world capabilities of the aircraft? These are early days, anything is possible, although some inferences can be made. Firstly, it has been suggested that the priority of the KF-21 is not stealth, as with the F-35 and F-22, but rather a balance between reduced radar cross-section and maximum weapons payload. This has been made obvious in the choice to mount weapons externally rather than internally as in other fifth-gen stealth aircraft. With four hardpoints on the fuselage and six on the wings, this could suggest a similar radar cross-section to the Typhoon. In fact, during development, one of the project's goals was to produce an aircraft capable of outperforming both the Dassault Rafale and the Typhoon, and the aircraft has been referred to as a 4.5-gen, not fifth-gen design. One of the more popular commentaries, and one which appears to be in line with the goals of the South Korean Air Force, is that the KF-21 will serve as an intermediary between the stealthier F-35 and the cheaper F-16. Sitting in the middle, the KF-21 could carry more weaponry than the F-35 with an internal load, but retain a smaller radar image than the F-16. This could prove beneficial in joint missions in which the strengths of each aircraft are utilized: stealth from the F-35, speed and dogfighting ability from the F-16, and a steady middle ground from the KF-21. During production, it was stated that the aircraft should outperform the F-16 in several areas, namely 50% greater combat range, a better AESA radar and data link, and a 30% longer lifespan. Powering the aircraft is the General Electric F414. Currently in use on the Super Hornet and newer variants of the Jazz 39 Gripen, the engine strikes a good middle ground, powerful, whilst also reducing fuel burn rate and maintenance time. With the GE400K variant of this power plant, current information suggests that the KF-21 will be able to reach 1200 knots, or Mach 1.8, with a combat range of up to 1000 kilometers. This is substantially better than the F-16's 500 kilometer combat range. In terms of armament, the KF-21 can carry 7,700 kilograms of stores. This happens to be the exact amount that the F-16 is rated to carry. The aircraft also comes equipped with an electronic warfare suite, which will be further enhanced in the two-seater version, along with AESA radar, infrared search and track, and an electro-optical targeting system.
보셨듯이 외국에서 제작했음에도 선입견 없이 KF-21의 개발 과정과 목표, 실제 성능을 객관적으로 분석한 영상이었는데요. 그리고 이 채널에서 KF-21을 이렇게 세밀하게 분석한 진짜 이유가 영상 말미에 언급되었습니다.
Thus far, the KF-21 looks promising as a native design for the South Koreans. Even though they are launching the aircraft without full multi-role capabilities, for a smaller country, this still marks the beginning of an aerospace industry capable of competing at the highest international level. The development of this aircraft serves as a lesson that small nations, not the least of which being Australia, can and should produce original aircraft domestically. During the Second World War, under threat of Japanese invasion, Australia did indeed prove itself capable of developing its own aircraft. The current turbulent geopolitical environment should prompt policymakers towards sustainable domestic capabilities in terms of aircraft and ordnance production. It is easy to imagine the Australian continent isolated from allied supply lines. It has the resources to produce great original military equipment, which would help secure the nation, bolster Australian industries, and open many more employment opportunities. One can only hope that the South Korean KF-21 program might inspire Canberra along these lines.
실제로 KF-21 개발 성공은 많은 국가들에게 영감을 주었는데요. 고등 훈련기에서 곧바로 초음속 전투기로 점프하겠다는 한국의 계획은 무모하다는 비판을 받았었지만 실제로 이루어내자 많은 국가들이 우리도 할 수 있겠다는 근거 없는 자신감을 가지게 되었습니다. 튀르키예의 5세대 전투기 개발 프로젝트 TFX는 KF-X 프로그램의 자극을 받아 발족되었으며 인도, 대만을 비롯해 여러 국가에서도 국산 전투기 개발 프로젝트가 시작됐었죠. 하지만 현재 진행 중인 차세대 전투기 프로젝트 중에 KF-21만큼 확실한 결과물을 내놓은 곳은 단 한 곳도 없는 상황입니다. 한국도 할 수 있으니 나도 할 수 있겠다고 뛰어든 후에야 한국이 얼마나 말도 안 되는 일을 이루어낸 것인지를 체감하고 있습니다. 그렇기 때문인지 가장 많은 추천을 받은 댓글들을 살펴보면 호주도 새로운 전투기를 개발해야 한다는 이야기보다는 한국의 KF-21 프로젝트에 합류해야 한다는 의견이 많았는데요. 훌륭한 영상이지만 지적할 부분이 있습니다. 한국은 작은 나라가 아니라 세계에서 손꼽히는 경제강국이자 군사강국이며 세계 최고 수준의 고정밀 엔지니어링 기술을 보유하고 있습니다. 한국의 산업공학적 역량은 인도, 터키, 호주보다 훨씬 뛰어납니다. 또한 무기 개발 프로젝트가 정부 차원에서 진행되고 이를 통해 글로벌 무대에서 혁신과 경쟁력을 주도하고 있습니다. 호주가 같은 일을 해낼 수 있을 거라고 확신할 수 없습니다. 호주에 있어 KF-21은 정말 좋은 선택이 될 것입니다. 인도네시아가 계약과 다른 과도한 기술 이전을 요구하며 수년간 분담금 지급을 미루고 있는 상황에서 한국에 가장 가까운 동맹국 중 하나인 호주가 인도네시아의 몫을 담당한다면 한국에서도 매우 환영해 줄 것입니다. 호주도 KF-21 프로젝트에 참여해야 합니다. 인도네시아는 1단계 파트너일 뿐이고 현재 폴란드와 아랍에미리트가 두 번째 단계의 파트너가 되기를 바라고 있습니다. 호주도 2단계에 참여해야만 하며 한국은 미국이나 프랑스 등 다른 전투기 생산 국가들과 달리 기술을 공유하고 현지 생산을 허가해줄 의사가 있습니다. KF-21은 유지보수 비용을 포함해 대당 비용이 가장 적고 다른 전투기에 비해 많은 장점을 가지고 있습니다. 동의합니다. 호주도 이 새로운 전투기 프로젝트에 참여해야 합니다. 한국은 언제나 고품질 제품을 생산하죠. KF-21이 내수용 전투기를 넘어 국제 무대로 나아가기 위해서는 더욱 많은 파트너들이 필요하고 인도네시아와 달리 호주는 얼마든지 믿을 수 있는 사업 파트너입니다. 또한 파이브 아이즈에 속해 있는 호주가 미국 대신 한국의 전투기를 선택한다면 그 자체로도 시장에 큰 충격을 불러일으키겠죠. 호주 이외에도 세계 각국의 네티즌들이 KF-21에 흥미를 드러내며 자국에서 KF-21을 도입하길 바란다는 댓글을 달았는데요. 한국 방산이 국제적인 신뢰를 받고 있다는 걸 보여주며 KF-21이 예상만큼 훌륭한 전투기로 대비할 수 있다면 향후 확실하게 국제 전투기 시장을 점유할 수 있을 것으로 기대받고 있습니다. KF-21 보라매가 하루빨리 완성되어 세계를 향해 날아오를 수 있기를 바랍니다. 끝까지 시청해주셔서 감사합니다. 도움이 되셨다면 좋아요를, 다른 이야기도 궁금하시면 구독을 눌러주세요.